Assalamu alaikum. Hello everybody. We are happy to have you here today at our reading session. And I would like to introduce you our guest, Dr. Nader Hashemi, the director of the Center for Middle East Studies and associate professor at Denver University. We are here to discuss Dr. Nader's book about Islam and liberal democracy and secularism. But not only that, and I encourage you to ask questions maybe about something which you always wanted to know about Islam and secularism, but always were afraid to ask. So I would like to give a word to Dr. Nader for him to introduce his book a bit to us, and then we will pass to the question and answer session.
Okay, well, thank you for having me here, and I have to say that this is a book that comes out of my doctoral dissertation that I wrote at the University of Toronto. And so I wrote the book a long time ago, because I got my PhD in 2005, and then I revised the book for publication. But the basis of the book is rooted in my PhD at the University of Toronto, and why I chose to write on this topic, the relationship between Islam, democracy, and secularism, has to do with my own lived experience, being, you know, born into a Muslim family, raised as a Muslim, but living in a secular society. The tension and the difference between what I was hearing in the community that I was raised, Canada at that time, where secularism and democracy were sort of dominant values, but within a an Islamic context, those political concepts were deeply contested when I was growing up, particularly secularism. And so trying to think about the relationship between religion and democracy, but specifically religion, in this case Islam, secularism, democracy, has been really a long-standing interest of mine. And so when I decided to pursue a PhD, I wanted to think about these issues at a much deeper level, and so I stopped what I was doing in terms of my political activism and had a chance to spend 5 years just reading and writing on the topic. And so the core sort of paradox or problematic of my book revolves around the following tension. Democracy, as we understand it as a modern political system, requires some form of religion-state separation or secularism in order to sustain itself. But on the other hand, the main political, cultural, and intellectual resources that are at the disposal of Muslim democratic forces comes out of a religious or theological framework. So liberal democracy requires some form of secularism, but Muslim democratic forces are drawing upon an intellectual heritage that is coming out of a theological background. So there's a tension there. And trying to resolve that tension or that paradox from the perspective of democratic theory is the paradox that my book seeks to illuminate and to unravel. And so I make three arguments in the book, but the three arguments are fundamentally premised on challenging a widely held assumption in the social sciences, the Western social sciences, that believe or that sort of supposes or assumes that religious politics and democratic development are incompatible. There's an assumption that if you are introducing religious ideas into the public sphere, specifically Muslim ideas into the public sphere, that is a disaster for democracy and a disaster for human rights. And I wanted to sort of challenge that argument because in part it wasn't an argument that conformed with my lived experience in terms of how I understood internal debates within Muslim societies to play themselves out. And so I advance in that framework three sort of three claims. Number one, democracy, yes, I acknowledge, requires some form of religious state separation or secularism. But what one needs to think about in that context is that, you know, religious traditions are not born with an inherent democratic or secular orientation. These ideas have to be socially constructed and developed. And so if you go back in the case of Christianity or other religious traditions, contrary to what you sometimes hear, Christianity was not born with an inherent capacity to become democratic or to separate religion-state separation. So how do religious traditions develop over time? How do they socially construct an understanding of secularism? How does that understanding of secularism or religion-state separation become indigenized within a political culture? This is an often neglected sort of part of the debate on democracy, and I wanted to weigh in on that debate. And one of the arguments that I make in that context is that religious ideas often transform themselves, and they're adapted, and new religious interpretations can be produced that can allow for the process of democratization and the process of religious state separation to take place. And also in that context of thinking about how religious traditions transform themselves and become democratic and come to appreciate some form of religious state separation, there's not one model that fits all. That there are different models of religious state separation that exist in different parts of the world. And one of the challenges is to come up with the different models that could exist within Muslim-majority societies. The second broad theme that I look at and the argument that I make is that in societies where religion is a key marker of identity, the road to democracy, whatever twists and turns it makes along the way, cannot avoid passing through the gates of religious politics. So the path to democracy, in other words, particularly in societies where religion is a marker of identity, such as Muslim-majority societies, the path toward democracy cannot avoid passing through the gates of religious politics. And what I mean by that is that the question of religion's role in government, the question of religion's role in politics, is an inherent and inevitable part of the struggle for democracy in societies where religion is a key marker of identity. And that is something that can't be ignored, avoided. In other words, the process of democratization in these societies that have religious activists, the process of democratization cannot be artificially delinked from debates about the normative role of religion in government. And this is actually one reason why there has been a lot of political stability and tension in the case of Muslim-majority societies, in contrast to the Western experience, is because this process of democratization, which is inherently a destabilizing and difficult process, is happening at the exact same time when Muslim societies are also trying to resolve the question and negotiate the question of what role religion should play in government, which is another inherently destabilizing and conflict-ridden process. In the case of the European experience, these things did take place, but they took place in a much longer period of time. They didn't overlap. In the case of Muslim-majority societies, they're happening within a much shorter historical time period and at the same time. And so these two destabilizing processes are deeply delinked. They're happening together, and they partially explain why I think there's a lot of internal turmoil and chaos within Muslim-majority societies because of that overlapping between democratization and debates on the role of religion in government. And finally, the argument that I make is that there's often an intimate and ignored relationship between religious reformation and political development. The first typically precedes the second, although the processes are deeply interwoven and interconnected. And this is particularly true in societies that are under the sway of an illiberal or undemocratic religio-political doctrine. Democratization and liberalization, I argue, do not necessarily require the privatization of religion, but they do require a reinterpretation of religious ideas with respect to the moral basis of legitimate political authority that can be democratic, and also reinterpretation of religious ideas that can enhance human rights. And this is something that has happened in the case of the Western tradition, particularly the Catholic tradition, which I talk about, which has a lot of parallels to what's happening in the Islamic world today. And so overall, my book really is an attempt to rethink democratic theory and to insert within debates about democratic theory the question of religion's role in the process and struggle for democracy, and I do this by approaching the topic historically, comparatively, both in terms of the broad theoretical connections, how some of these debates have played out in the case of the West, and then looking at the contemporary case of the Islamic world. And I look at Indonesia, Iran, and Turkey, where at the time when I was writing, those were the places where exciting things were happening. And so that, in a nutshell, is my book. I was happy that Oxford University Press was able to publish it, and that's partly due to the generosity of John Esposito, who was supportive of the book, and it got some nice blurbs from people whose work I respect, particularly Khalid Abul Fadl at UCLA, and Charles Taylor, and a few other people. And you know, the book is, if you read it, there's chapters that are deeply dense. There's like a long, sort of very boring and dry chapter that looks at the political thought of John Locke, and it's not something that I would want anyone to read, because it'll immediately put you to sleep unless you're interested in political theory. But this is what, you know, academics have to do to get tenure. You have to write these dry, boring books, and they have to pass that vetting process. It's not a book for the average person, although there are some stuff there that, you know, I think a general audience can read and learn from. You know, I'm happy it got published, and, you know, I reached a point. I was teaching a course on Islam and democracy, but when you deal with an intellectual project, you reach a certain point after dealing with it for several years, where you just come to despise it. You don't want to talk about it, you don't want to deal with it, you just want to move on. So I reached that stage several years ago, and I wasn't really doing much work on Islam and democracy. But when the Arab Spring happened, I sort of revisited the question, and I added a new preface to the book that sort of looks at the question of the Arab Spring and tries to apply those developments to the book. And I, you know, I'm happy to say that I think what I wrote in this book did sort of prefigure some of the debates in the Arab Spring, particularly in the case of Tunisia, and that's my book. So I'll look forward to your questions and comments and thoughts.
I wanted just to ask a short question. You just said about John Locke and many progressive thinkers in the Muslim world.
Yeah.
They trying to quote from John Locke.
Yeah.
But do you think it is really applicable in the realities of the Muslim world?
Yeah.
And isn't it that romantic?
Yeah. Yes and no. When you're going to compare someone who wrote in the, you know, 16th century with someone who's, you know, applied those ideas to the 21st century, you have to acknowledge the differences. A very different world. Very different, you know, a set of circumstances, you know, domestically, regionally, internationally. So there's a lot of differences, but at the same time, there's a lot of parallels. One of the things that I loved about John Locke when I started to read him, I read Western political theory at a much later stage in my career, when I had a much firmer grasp of contemporary Middle East and Islamic politics. So I started to read Western political theory with that as a background. And one of the things that immediately struck me was when I would read these giants in Western political thought, how their religious ideas had a lot of similarity and relevance to contemporary debates in the Muslim world. And this was something that I was very interested in, because most of my professors had no interest in that. The issue of the role of religion in politics. In fact, if you study Western political thought, one of the ways that I was taught is that you will start with the ancient sort of classic texts in Greece. You will read Plato, you'll read Aristotle. And then the next book that's on the canon, the required reading list, is Machiavelli. And then you read Hobbes and Locke, and then you move forward. But what's interesting, if you think about it, so you read the ancient classic texts in Greece, and then you move to Machiavelli in the 14th, 15th century. There's a 1500-year period that Western political thinkers completely, that academia completely avoids. And that was the period when Europe was very religious, when there were deep religious debates. And even when you look at some of the early foundational thinkers that shaped modern liberal democracy, Hobbes and particularly Locke and Rousseau, their religious writings don't really factor into how Western political thought is taught to American students, because those religious ideas have no relevance to contemporary debates in the West, because the question of religion's role in the polis have long been resolved. But what I was so fascinated is when I would read Hobbes and I would read particularly Locke, Locke's writings on religion have a lot of relevance to the contemporary Islamic world, because like contemporary Muslim thinkers, John Locke was deeply concerned about the role of religion in public life. And he was a thinker who, like contemporary Muslim activists and intellectuals, had one foot in tradition and one foot in modernity. And he was trying to sort of advance new ideas with respect to religion-state relations, but in the context of a very religious society, in a context where in order to advance new ideas, you had to be an expert in the Bible, in scripture. And so John Locke's most famous book on political thought that is really considered a foundational text for modern liberal democracy is a book called The Two Treatises of Government. And it's called The Two Treatises of Government because there's a first treatise and a second treatise. But the book that's only read today is The Second Treatise of Government, where he talks about ideas of the consent of the governed and when you can rebel. But that book, The Second Treatise of Government, is predicated on the first book. The first book isn't read, but if you actually read that book, what's so fascinating, this is a book where he engages in a debate that's very relevant to contemporary Muslim, I think, political thought. The book is basically, book one, is basically an attempt by Locke to deal with the issue and to repudiate the dominant view of politics and religion-state relations at the time that claimed that political authority was rooted in the divine right of kings. The kings were in power because they were basically representatives of God, and they had to be respected because they were the embodiment of divine authority. And so John Locke realizes that before he can advance an alternative notion of legitimate political authority rooted in the consent of the governed and rooted in more democratic ideas where rights are respected, you have to first deal with and debunk the existing dominant theme that was relevant at the time. And that was the notion of the divine right of kings. That was the notion of close religion-state union and the claim that kings were, you know, basically the descendants or the representatives of God on earth. And if you read that book, what's so fascinating, it's a book that's inundated and completely consumed by reinterpreting the Bible. It's quotation after quotation, and he basically makes an argument that the dominant claim, that those people who claim that there is a biblical requirement that necessitates supporting the divine right of kings, that that claim is rooted in a fundamental misinterpretation of the Bible. The Bible does not make that claim. There's no evidence to support that claim. And if you read the Bible, particularly the New Testament, the Bible, he says, is basically silent on the question of what constitutes what he calls a Christian commonwealth. He says basically it's an open field. The existing standards and claims, and he actually debunks it and goes into deep, intimate religious scripture, which is why the chapter that I use in my book on Locke is actually called Dueling Scriptures. Locke is engaged in this sort of, you know, deep theological refutation. And so what I liked about Locke and what I see is relevant in terms of applying him to the contemporary Muslim world, is you have Muslim activists and thinkers who are interested in advancing new ideas. They also have to engage in a deep understanding of their own text. They have to know the text of the community that they're working in. They have to, in fact, know it better than their adversaries. And John Locke actually sort of demonstrates this. In fact, he engages in this refutation of an argument by one of these advocates of the divine right of king. And he basically quotes from scripture much more frequently and much more, I think, authoritatively than those advocates of the divine right of king who are claiming to use the Bible. He shows that he's well-versed and better-versed than his adversaries and is able to basically debunk their arguments. And so I think that struck me as being something that's very similar to the debates that I would have when I would confront, you know, certain members of the Muslim Students Association on my campus, and they were saying that everything is haram and you can't have, you know, these new ideas because... So Locke is very useful because he was operating in a very religious context. He was advocating new ideas. His strategy of how he advances new ideas and maintains his own integrity and authority within his own community struck me as being relevant and useful in terms of... And of course, Locke is also a founding father of liberal democracy. So his methodology and plan and strategy for advancing new ideas in a religious context was one that I thought had relevance, and it really spoke to me. So there is, I think, there are lessons to be, you know, learned here in terms of the Muslim world. But there's also there's big differences. When Locke was living, for example, and he was arguing and advancing ideas, particularly on religious state separation, which is an argument that he has in his very famous book called, a very small pamphlet called A Letter Concerning Toleration, the nature of religion within his own society is very different than the nature of religion in our society, particularly Muslim societies today. When Locke was writing, it was a period of post-Reformation Europe when there were multiplicity of new and emerging Protestant sects, each of them competing and arguing against each other. There was dozens of religions, basically, that were completely intolerant and antagonistic. And then there was the Catholic Church on top of that. And so he's, you know, advances an argument for what I call soft secularism based on that plurality of religious voices and the deep tension and animosity that existed. That same atmosphere doesn't exist in the case of the Muslim world today. You don't have the same type of pluralism and deep divisive debate among Muslims. You have a Sunni tradition, you have a Shia tradition. Most Muslims are Sunni, and there's a general sort of view that these are the, you know, the acceptable schools of thought, and the nature of the religious tension and divides today in the Islamic world are very different. So you can't apply hook, line, and sinker what Locke was doing to what's happening today. But there are other things that, you know, he does have to say that are relevant for, you know, particularly Muslims who are interested in political thought. You know, this is not an argument that I would expect, you know, any Muslim, you know, just to be, you know, captured with. So from the perspective of, you know, my own interest, someone who's interested in political ideas, I naturally gravitated to that, and I wrote about it. But you know, I wouldn't encourage people to read that particular chapter because it's very dense, and it's not going to appeal to you. In fact, it'll probably, like I said, put you to sleep. So
anti-AIDS campaign.
Yeah.
Your book.
Yeah.
Okay. Probably we pass to the questions. Hasman is the first.
Assalamualaikum.
Islam.
Firstly, thank you, Professor Hashim, for writing that book.
Yeah.
I finished reading that.
Oh, good.
Like 2 years ago.
Oh, good. You're one of the five people in the world who've read the book. You know.
My first question is that, resonating from what Khalid Abu Al-Fadl wrote in his essay entitled Islam and the Challenge of Democracy.
Right.
I believe you know that essay well.
Yeah, I do.
One of the biggest challenge in reconciling or developing a democratic theory within Islamic tradition is that the idea of authority of God versus the autonomy of man.
Right.
And because we know in the mainstream Muslim view, there are some doctrines within Islam which are immutable, such as homosexuality, which is clearly haram in the Islamic tradition. And if the society democratically decides that they are to condone homosexuality, so what will it be in that society? So my question is that, how do we reconcile these two tension between these two ideas?
Two ideas?
I mean, the authority of God and the autonomy of democratic deliberation.
Yeah.
Do we need to limit the scope of democratic decision, or do we need to redefine what the central Islamic doctrines are?
Yeah, see, this issue of, you know, sovereignty has been one of the big bones of contention that really consumed a lot of Muslim thinkers for a big part of the 20th century. I'm happy to report that I think that issue has largely been resolved. No one brings up these debates anymore. You know, because there's a general sense that, look, you know, Muslim political parties would benefit from having democratic elections. But it does speak to, you know, a certain anxiety that really... ...in 2007 when they wrote their political platform. They, reflecting, I think, the anxiety that you just articulated, were very reluctant to allow for full popular sovereignty to shape the political future of Egypt in this case, and they insisted on having, like they do in the Iranian case, a certain council of religious elders to make sure that decisions that are made by the population are subject to an Islamic sort of check and balance, because they fear, precisely as you hinted at, that Muslim political thinkers were deeply concerned about the question of popular sovereignty. We just can't allow the, you know, the masses to determine what they want. What happens if they pass legislation that is un-Islamic? And so they've always sort of played with this issue. They didn't know what to do. But thankfully, in the context of this particular debate, I think much more new ideas have emerged that have argued that, look, in a Muslim-majority society, if people are overwhelmingly, you know, Muslim, the most likely scenario, if you sort of had any sort of public debate, is that people are going to vote for policies and positions that reflect their particular religious identity. The fear that somehow the entire religion of Islam is going to come crashing down unless you had a guardian council monitoring public decisions is an exaggerated fear. It's one that doesn't really stand up to sort of you know, critical scrutiny if you look at it. And that debate now has shifted. No one really brings up those debates anymore. It was big a generation ago or two generations ago. It's died away. But it's, you know, it's not something that's uniquely Islamic. If you look at debates within the Catholic Church, they also had similar anxieties about, you know, democracy. I mean, the Catholic Church until relatively recently in the 1960s rejected democracy, rejected women's rights, rejected liberalism, rejected everything because they felt that, you know, much more than contemporary Muslim thinkers, that it was all, you know, disconnected with what God wanted and what the Catholic Church stood for. But thankfully, that reinterpretation in the case of the Catholic Church came about and it allowed for a certain advancement and democratic gains and transitions within Catholic-majority countries. And also, in the case of the Muslim world, you also had, I think, a rethinking. I mean, the best formulation of this particular issue of, you know, God's sovereignty versus people's sovereignty, one argument that you often hear is that, you know, who can legitimately claim to speak in the name of God, you know? Even if someone claims to be a cleric or a learned, you know, alim, whatever interpretation of Islam that they articulate, it's going to still be human interpretation. And to claim that they are somehow speaking in God's name in and of itself is the equivalent of shirk, is the equivalent of sort of usurping God's position, and that in and of itself is one of the biggest, you know, sins within Islamic practice. So any interpretation is going to be subject to human error. And so that sort of suggests that there should be, you know, if everyone is subject to the same possibility of human error, well then we don't need this, you know, advisory council to monitor things. The other argument that Khalid Abu Fadl makes in terms of his book that you mentioned is a different argument than a debate over the question of sovereignty. His argument is very convincing. He says that, what does fundamentally Islam stand for and what is its most, you know, one of its most important values? And he sort of quotes all these verses from the Quran and talks about how the importance of justice. Justice is an important value that matters in terms of, you know, Islamic society. And so he looks and he says, well, which political system best sort of advances a just society? And so he goes through sort of the principles of democracy that are best in keeping with the broad conception of justice. The idea of accountable government, separation of powers, you know, human rights. Those societies that tend to be upholding those values tend to be more just, and therefore among the other competing political systems that we have, those ones are more closer to an Islamic ideal than any other political system. And so that little essay that he has, what's so interesting about it is that it's an essay written from the perspective of an Islamic legal scholar who does not quote John Locke, doesn't quote any other Western sources. It's an authentically internal Muslim sort of argument in favor of liberal democracy, focusing on the fundamental values that liberal democracy claims to uphold in advance and how those values actually can be reconciled with the fundamental values of Islamic politics or Islamic norms and values. So it's a very convincing sort of little essay that I find is very useful in terms of, you know, engaging in these debates with Muslims because it comes from someone who has a lot of authority as an Islamic studies scholar. If you read the essay, I think you'll come to the same conclusion as well.
Please pass the microphone.
But I think, unfortunately, this is not what is being taught in the university, say, in Malaysia, the International Islamic University. I don't think they're teaching Khalid Abu Fadil at all. So, actually, this whole belief is still constructed and used here, that this is God's law versus
man's
law. And so those groups that are pushing for change, pushing for reform, you know, like Sisters in Islam, you know, we are often, until this very day, I mean, for over 20 years, that's the same argument. They've not shifted their argument. You know, that you don't have a right to talk about Islam. Your demand for change, for reform, for equality, for justice are all against Islam. You're using, they actually even, and I think it's amazing how shameless they are to say that in Islam, you cannot use aqab.
They say that?
They say that. Yeah. The answers are all in the Quran. Yeah. So they are shameless, even though the debate, the scholarship have shifted.
Yeah.
So this is where, because Islam is a political, you know, Islam is used as a political ideology. This is all for political contestation, to gain power, to remain in power, to maintain Muslim privileges and Muslim rights.
Yeah.
They're using, instrumentalizing religion in a very, I don't know what word to use, you know. I mean, shameless just comes to mind, you know, devoid of scholarship, of religion, even.
Yeah.
So, and then you're doing this in an electorate that also does not read and does not keep up with the progress in Islamic scholarship. You know, so then you see, I mean, you know, this morning I was at a consultation and Ben from Merdeka Center was just presenting us all these survey results. You know, it's scary when you look at the incredible difference between Muslim opinion and non-Muslim opinion on a whole range of issues, the divide. You know, non-Muslim would be like 20%, Muslim would be 70% support for hudud law, support for all kinds of conservative positions in Islam.
You put your finger on something very important, and it sort of reminds me of this story that I told yesterday about one of the great sort of 20th century Muslim scholars, Fazlur Rahman.
Yeah.
You know, so Fazlur Rahman was Pakistani, and he gets his PhD, I think, from England, and he goes back to Pakistan where he sets up an Islamic research institute, and he starts to research and write and advocate a new interpretation of Islam, particularly focusing on the question of modernity. Mm-hmm. And what he discovers, and this is in the mid-1960s, is that the dominant sort of clerical interpretation are very angry at what he's writing, and he basically flees Pakistan in the 1960s for his life, and he goes to the University of Chicago, where he ends up writing several important books, one of them being Islam and Modernity, the other one being, you know, his really great book on major themes of the Quran, and he comes up with what I would call a very sophisticated modernist interpretation of Islam. But the problem was that because he disengaged from his own society and became a university professor, he has a loyal following and influence among the graduate students that studied with him, who were maybe about 20 or 30 people. But if you talk to a Pakistani today about Fazlur Rahman, they don't know who you're talking about. But every Pakistani knows who Maulana Maududi is. And the reason is because not because Maulana Maududi's ideas are more intellectually sophisticated or engaging or relevant to the world in which we live in, or more Islamically authentic. Maulana Maududi had a network of supporters who disseminated his ideas at the grassroots level throughout Pakistan and throughout Pakistani communities. Well, Fazlur Rahman did. He was an intellectual. So just because you might have a more authentic or better idea on an issue, that doesn't matter in terms of, you know, the practical impact of those ideas in the society in which you live in. So I think one of the challenges of contemporary Muslim forces who are interested in reconciling tradition with modernity, Islam with democracy and human rights, is you need a ground game. You need a ground game that can work at the local level and that can, to the extent possible, disseminate your ideas. If you don't, then the dominant interpretation is going to remain dominant. And there's not much that could be done about it. So that's sort of, I think, you know, how I look at this. And this, of course, you know, requires a completely different strategy, because in order to get your ideas disseminated at grassroots level, it really requires a completely new approach. You have to have people who are willing to, you know, sacrifice, who are willing to go into these communities, who are willing to sort of spend time there and engage in the very difficult task of interpretation and dissemination. And most of us, you know, don't have the time or the ability to do that. So, you know, that's one big problem. The other big problem is, as you sort of hinted at, we have, you know, political parties and leaders who have no interest in, you know, anything related to justice or Islamic authenticity. They're interested in perpetuating their own political power, and so they will use very underhanded political tactics to manipulate people's emotional appeal to their religion, to silence other voices, and to advance very nefarious readings of Islam in order to stay in power. And, you know, that poses the question, well, what do you do about that particular reality? And, you know, there's no simple answer, but I think to the extent that you're allowed to articulate a point of view, to allow that your political system allows you some freedom of movement, well, then you have to take advantage of those opportunities to support political forces that might be more in line with your own views and ideas, to try and get them elected. You know, thankfully, social media can be helpful here, because it's much more difficult for authoritarian regimes and repressive leaders to dominate what people have access to. But of course, the people who are susceptible to those interpretations of Islam and that will vote for existing political parties are people who often don't read the internet and are often live a much more simple lifestyle, and you know, don't have access to these more, I would argue, Islamically authentic and relevant interpretations. So this is where the challenge is. I think this is where, I think, ideally, if it was up to me, if I had the resources, I would send as many students as I could, give them scholarships to go study in the traditional sort of places of Islamic learning, but at the same time require that they be deeply engaged with a modern understanding of human rights and democracy. In fact, I would get as many students to sort of go and get their PhDs with Khalid Abu al-Fadl. And there's actually a comparison and a relationship here, because when Fazlur Rahman was in the University of Chicago, it just so happened that three young Muslim activists from Indonesia were given scholarships who went to study with Fazlur Rahman, one of them being the late, great Nur Khalis Majid, who went and got his PhD, and these three students went back to Malaysia and really had an impact in terms of how Islam was understood, how you relate it with modernity, how, you know, back in the early 1970s, and I talk about this in my book, in the early 1970s, Indonesian Muslim students were having debates about secularism. This is unheard of in anywhere in the Muslim world, and of course they paid a big price for doing so, but at least, you know, you can see in the practice of Indonesian Islam a very different experience, in part because you had people who went and, in this case, studied with Fazlur Rahman, had solid grounding in a new interpretation of Islam that was authentically Islamic, but also were deeply engaged with their own society. And then they went back, and they spent time, and they were involved in politics, and they organized, and they mobilized, and they made a difference. You know, that's a model there that I think really, you know, one needs to study and emulate, because I think it could perhaps produce similar types of positive results that we saw in the case of the Indonesian experience.
Actually, one of the Indonesian students, yeah, you mentioned a student of Fazlur Rahman.
Yeah.
He was here last month, sitting at your seat.
Oh, really? Which one?
Professor Shafi Marif.
Yeah. He was here, so I'm honored to be sitting in this.
Yeah, same seat. Okay, that's all. That's my comments.
I got a question. You know, I take the point that if you want to change the traditional society, you've got to speak the language at least first.
Right.
But taking a, you know, if you think about the situation logically and you project forward and you look at the European or the Western experience, like John Locke's first volume is no longer discussed, right?
Right.
So can we make the projection and say that at some stage this situation will also follow us? I wouldn't say exactly that pattern, but for us to make any progress in a technological, as I've said yesterday and today, you know, we run a society, it's got to be work. We need to allocate resources, we've got to perform, right? So if that is the case, can we say that if we make progress, it means that at some stage we would be able to talk about things at the rational level, at the empirical level, and be talking much less about religion? Can you accept that, would you?
I think having rational conversations, yes. I'd like to think so, but you know, there's examples that one can cite that sort of steady sort of progress toward modernity in an emerging democracy is not necessarily a guaranteed phenomenon. So take, for example, the country that I currently live in, the United States. It's one of the longest standing democracies in the world. It's a very free and open society. But you have today a lot of people in the United States that hold views that are completely unimaginable. I mean, cannot be explained. You have a lot of Americans, you know, who seriously believe that their own government is out to get them. They believe that their own president, you know, one-third, the last poll that I saw, one-third of the members of the Republican Party believed that the existing president of the United States was actually not a citizen of their own society. They thought Barack Obama was a Kenyan, you know, Muslim who, you know, really didn't have. There was a big, I don't know if you know this, but when Obama was first elected, this big issue emerged, not about his family's background, but as to whether he was actually born in Hawaii or not. And this big debate emerged over his birth certificate. Why hasn't Obama produced his birth certificate? And I remember reading at the time that the state of Hawaii every day was getting 10 requests to get a copy of his birth certificate. And this character who is a big name in the United States, Donald Trump, made a big stink about this and kept talking about it and talking about it until finally Obama had to sort of, you know, resolve the matter where he had to get a copy of his birth certificate and show it and say, here. And even then some people didn't believe him. So you have an open society in the United States, but you have a lot of people there who are willing to believe things that are just completely irrational. You have a lot of people in the United States who, you know, believe in, you know, just an obsessive sort of necessity to own guns. When the debate that Obama started with respect to health care, which is something that, you know, most modern societies have, where people are just entitled to basic health care, half of the country does not believe that. And they think that, you know, they've used this term called Obamacare, which is now a swear word. You know, how dare Obama try and give sort of access to health? So you have an open society, but you have a lot of people. And the reason why you have that, I think, is because in the case of the United States, you have a lot of money and you have a lot of powerful interest groups who are willing to manipulate, to buy off politicians, and to advance. I mean, the other issue in terms of, you know, the United States that's even more shocking, perhaps, is many Americans don't believe in the whole idea of the destruction of the climate, that there's a global warming problem. They think that's all a complete fabrication. Now, more on the Republican side than on the Democrats, but I remember when I went for a job interview once in Texas when I was in a... going for the interview, and we're having dinner. You know, it's standard when you go for these job interviews, you go out to dinner with the faculty. And so one of the faculty members turns to me and says, oh, so I hear you're from Canada. And I go, yes. And then he says, do you guys believe in global warming up there? Yeah, we do, because, you know, the scientific evidence sort of suggests that. So you have people in the United States who believe in very crazy things, but it's an open, so there's no guarantee. And I think the reasons for that is because when you have political interest groups that are able to take out ads, that are able to influence politicians, they can manipulate. And this is a society with high levels of literacy and with access to information. So one has to be a little bit, you know, I think more circumspect and cautious about a straight path toward progress and modernity and rational ism if we just allow things to move in the proper direction. They can roll back.
Yeah. No, I wasn't suggesting it would be a straight path. In fact, I'm open to the idea that modernity need not necessarily follow one particular model.
Right.
It may incorporate most of what we already know that the West has got, because it's got the results to show for it, but we could add on or take out some parts, right?
Yeah.
So I'm more interested in that question in the sense that, you know, rational expectations. I don't know whether you have that kind of concept in your field. That means if you think that something is going to happen in the future, we might as well roll back that thought process and factor it and take decisions now that would make that become a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, if I expect land values will go up tomorrow, I will buy land now.
Right.
But the fact of buying land will drive up the prices.
Right.
So that kind of process applied to politics. Okay.
Yeah.
Second point is, you know, this thing about, you know, in Iran, what do you call it, a council? Of
Guardian Council.
Was that?
Guardian Council.
A Guardian Council.
Yeah.
Or maybe in past, we sort of think that the Shura Council tries to take on that kind of role.
Yeah.
You know, again, clearly this has got little to do with religion. China has told Hong Kong, which maybe you're aware of, that in 2017...
You just told me over lunch.
Oh, is that right? All candidates...
Yeah, have to be screened by the Chinese Guardian Council. Yeah.
For the position of chief executive would have to be from an approved list, right?
Right.
Approved by Beijing. And that's why the students are demonstrating for the last several weeks. So, you know, I mean, we see it in different contexts.
Yeah. Right? No, I agree with that. What I think you might be missing in your analysis is how, when you're dealing with deeply emotionally charged issues of identity, rational sort of predictions are often difficult because people feel scared. And particularly with respect to the question of Islam here, there's a lot of sense, and I think this is perhaps a question of, you know, Malaysia being outside of the Arab Islamic world, there is a sense that, you know, whatever comes from the Arab world is more authentic, and people just bow down to someone who can quote an Arabic verse, and I think that's... So when you're dealing with issues of identity, you're dealing with the realm of the psychological, which doesn't always follow a nice rational pattern. People are scared, they can be manipulated. And so it's a much more complex situation. It's not going to follow an easy pattern. And yet you'd like to hope that the answer to I hate all these words, conservative, liberal, and I just know what... But let's say... undemocratic readings of religion can be corrected by more democratic readings of religion if there's an open public sphere. But, you know, that's fine in the abstract. What people who are particularly living in rural and sort of more socially disadvantaged areas, they often are much more vulnerable and much more susceptible to political manipulation, particularly religious manipulation, over issues of identity. And so that is a factor that, you know, has to be part of a strategy of advancing democracy in fragile societies where there are interest groups who are willing to manipulate public opinion to advance their own agendas. Now, how you deal with that, I'm not sure, but that's definitely part of the problem, and it sort of undermines the assumption that if you can just give a rational explanation to someone, they'll understand it, and then they'll take the logical decision that follows from there.
Of course, in Malaysia, a complicating factor, as I think I shared with you over lunch yesterday, is we have a multiracial society,
right,
which is still in its stage of development. The calculus is strategic.
Yeah.
It's not bonded and emotional. Okay?
Yeah.
So the Malays use Islam as a kind of unifying force,
right,
as a shield. So when you have democratic type discourse that they think would weaken or fragment that shield, that terrifies a lot of people.
Yeah, yeah.
But in my view, of course, that if you continue to carry that shield, it would become a piece of dead weight.
Right.
That would sink the Malay society in its progress.
Yeah.
But the non-Malays are not going to be the party that can lead this kind of discussion. You see. So
here's a question: is there any possibility of a political movement emerging in this country that draws upon different, you know, ethnic groups, but is unites people around a common agenda based on a certain principle of equality among everyone, but that can sort of challenge, you know, those more ethnically based conceptions of... Is there any possibility of that happening in the near future?
I think it is already happening, right?
Yeah.
But the core Malay Muslim identity, in yeah. which you seek to link the two,
yeah.
is deeply rooted for the kind of reasons you've talked about.
Yeah.
Right? So perhaps, you know, the Malay civilization has got only 500-600 years, if you yeah. come from the Malacca Sultanate days.
Yeah.
If you tack on Islam, then it extends it by at least 1,600 years.
Right.
Well, does that sound like a reasonable yeah. kind of thinking way to understand the situation? I mean, maybe I should pose that to sisters in Islam.
Malay civilization.
If you take Paras Maharaj, of course, much better, but then it becomes Hindu.
If you right? use the term Malay civilization, so yeah. it would be more than, it has to be before 15th century. Because the Malay were Hindu, Buddhist.
Precisely. What I'm saying is that obviously now in the modern context,
yeah.
there are people who want to draw a line.
Muslim,
Malay Muslim, right? Anything yeah. Hindu, we don't want to know about it, right? I mean, yeah. so if we stop there, the only way to get a longer picture mm. is to add on
yeah.
Islam.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know whether that would be a fair. I mean, kind of
for, I think for me, the really the biggest challenge we're facing is it's really how the government, how UMNO in particular, is using race and religion,
yeah.
you know, to deal, you know, with their, you know, legitimacy, popularity, you know, just,
yeah.
you know, going down in legitimacy, going down in popularity,
yeah.
and they don't know how to deal. You know, the other issues of, you know, that the public is concerned about, you know, whether it's corruption, you know, inequalities and
yeah.
all that are difficult challenges because their own interests,
yeah.
You know,
are
affected.
Yeah.
So it's so there is a strategic use of race and religion
right.
to win support, to
yeah.
maintain their support base, to
right.
expand their support base. So and they have the massive powers of the state
yeah.
behind them,
yeah.
whether it's the police, you know, the security apparatus, the education system,
yeah.
the media,
yeah. yeah,
you know, so we are facing that challenge,
yeah.
you know, so there are, you know, there's, you know, all these civil society groups,
yeah.
movements like Bersih, which
yeah.
is incredible, that brings people of all races
yeah.
together, but you're facing the might
yeah.
of a state
yeah.
that is using religion,
yeah.
You know, to keep the Malays
yeah.
together and to
yeah.
keep that support
yeah.
base together.
Yeah. No, that's a huge challenge, and,
mm.
and not to mention, you know, the financial resources that they
yeah.
have to sort
yeah.
of buy loyalty, purchase loyalty, manipulate. But I think on the positive side, at least, again, comparatively speaking,
mm.
you know, there seems to be a certain open space, at least, where people
yeah.
can organize here.
Mm.
And the state has limits in terms of how far it can go. And so that is something that is, I think, at least from my perspective, having looked at other countries, much more optimistic. It creates opportunities. The last vote, even though it, from what I hear, was partially rigged, but the popular vote was won by the opposition. That in itself is something to be encouraging, right? You won the popular vote. You didn't win, you know, a change in government, but you came pretty close. And plus, I also hear that it was an 83% voter turnout. That itself is quite encouraging as well, because one of the big problems in these situations is that people become apathetic and they say, I'm not going to care, I'm just going to go my own life. People don't want to organize and participate in politics, and that allows those political interests that have a constituency that will always vote for them because they have the money and the resources, they'll continue to dominate the system. So high voter turnout, the fact that, you know, those are all things that I think are working in Malaysia's favor, and I think one shouldn't lose sight of them, and they should give cause for hope and for continue organizing so that the next opportunity that comes around, perhaps one can you know, strike when the iron is hot, as they say.
Hi, Dr. Hashimi, this few days you have been speaking from the position of modernist Islam.
Mm-hmm.
But as you know, in contemporary Muslim worlds,
yeah.
the critique of modernity is also a source of inspirations and a source of driving us to think more critically about Islam.
Uh-huh.
So how, if we still maintain as a modernist Muslim,
uh-huh.
how do we reconcile the critique of modernity?
How do I reconcile it
yeah,
with
within
what?
A modernist framework.
Yeah.
And with that, some of the Muslim scholars are calling themselves progressive Muslims
mm-hmm.
rather than modernist Muslims.
Right.
So I would like to hear your view on
well,
this. Thank you.
I don't,
May I add something?
Sure, sure, go ahead. Yeah.
Building on that premise, one big critic on the modernist stream of thought within Islamist movements is that we do not have strong ground in the classical Islamic tradition, which they have, right. And they often quote,
right.
For example, Al-Mawardi Ahkam Sultaniyah,
right.
To you know, push for anti-democratic
right.
views.
Right.
So how do we reconcile between this classical Islamic classical text and the modern condition without being trapped in the idea of Islam versus modernity?
Well, again, I was talking about John Locke. If there's something to learn from John Locke, is you have to know your own heritage better than your adversaries. You have to be more well-versed, or at least as good. You have to be as fluent and conversant in your own religious heritage as your adversaries, because they will always try and browbeat you, and they will engage in what Khalid Abu Fadl once called a hadith hurling session with you, where they'll start throwing these Arabic phrases, and if you don't know what they mean, you're going to sort of think that, well, they must know what they're talking about. So one of the challenges here is to reconnect with your own heritage, to understand the original sources, and realize that all religious traditions are open to interpretation. There's a modernist interpretation, there's a conservative, anti-democratic interpretation. What I tend to find optimistic about this particular question is that when young Muslims in particular are given a choice to pick between different interpretations, they often gravitate to a modernist interpretation. And it's particularly those forces that are interested in silencing, arresting, intimidating modernist interpretations that is very revealing, because it suggests a certain lack of confidence and vulnerability in their own interpretation of Islam, that they go out of their way to silence other voices. Because if you were really confident in your own interpretation, you wouldn't go and engage in these types of thuggish intimidation tactics that we see in many Muslim societies around the world. So I think the answer is that you have to be well-versed in your own heritage, you have to know your own tradition, you also have to know, you know, what's happening in the modern world as well, and you have to be conversant in both. And if you can't do that, then you will always be browbeaten and intimidated and threatened by others who claim to speak for Islam's heritage, and you'll be at a disadvantage. And I think that's been a problem historically for us.
I think it was interesting during that whole, you know, I mean, in Pakistan, I think a few years ago, that whole, you know, all the extremism that's going on in Pakistan, there was one human rights lawyer who wrote an article saying that the mistake that the liberals did in Pakistan and the human rights activists did in Pakistan was to ignore religion.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And now many of those, you know, at the forefront of the liberal movement, they, you know, and they said they're too old now to learn about religion, you know, and they should have done this 20, 30 years ago. But this is, I mean, this is why Sisters in Islam exist as well, you know, because, you know, you cannot, I mean, religion cannot be the monopoly of the ulama or only the Islamist activists, because they speak about religion in ways that don't make sense to the realities of our lives. So within a democratic framework, you know, when religion is used as a source of law and public policy, all of us, you know, we need to build that courage and that confidence and the knowledge, of course, you know, to claim our right to speak on matters of religion. And too few people are willing to do that.
Yeah.
And I, you know, I mean, like, for us, when we first started, it was a shock for us to find out that the South Asians, Muslims, the Arab Muslims, you know, the feminists that we work with, the human rights activists that we work with, are hostile to religion.
Yeah.
And they were hostile to Sisters in Islam
working
with religion.
Yeah.
You know, why do you want to engage with religion? It's inherently unjust.
Yeah.
It's patriarchal. Religion has no role to play in the public space. Religion should, you know, be a private matter. So the whole secular argument completely buy into it, you know. So we were attacked by both the Islamists and the conservatives, and by the feminists and the human rights activists at the international level for engaging with religion. And I mean, but things have changed.
Yeah.
So I think increasingly people are realizing you know, that religion is not going to go away from public life, you know, and that you really need to engage with the religion. But it's still not enough.
It's still not enough. You have to go deeper. You have to, like I said, you have to develop to the extent that you can what's called a good ground game. You have to be able to be engaged in your local communities at a local level. To the extent that you can engage in a dialogue with other Muslims who have a more conservative interpretation, and they're willing to come and have a civil exchange of views, you should take advantage of those opportunities. I think those can be learning opportunities that can help decrease tension, and perhaps you can find some common ground. I think those are things that you don't see happening. Julia was asking me about this inter-Muslim dialogue that she sort of thought was happening among Muslim communities between different interpretations and generations. And I responded, what intra-Muslim dialogue are you talking about? I don't know of any dialogue happening in any Muslim community that I know of where actually Muslims from different ideological or interpretive perspectives are actually talking to one another. They're talking to separate communities. So that's a problem. I think a lot of those people who are part of the problem here, let's say in Malaysia, not all of them are beyond hope. I think if you can bring someone, let's say, for example, like a Khalid Abu Fadl, to engage in them with a discussion and debate, some of those people perhaps might can be brought over to our side. Not completely, but at least they might not be as hostile. Some people are just beyond reproach. You can't reach them. Because either they are ideologically beyond reach, they have no interest, or their material interests are vested in maintaining their own position because their livelihood and their careers are being financed by political interests. So I think, these are big questions and big problems, but I remember just to tell you a personal story, I remember when I was a Muslim student at Carleton University in Ottawa, we had a little Muslim study group where we were studying Fazlur Rahman, and I remember we were sitting in the Muslim prayer space, and it just so happened that one of the members of our group was a Muslim woman who was fluent in Arabic and knew the Quran and also was very ethically oriented. And one of the more conservative members of the Muslim brothers in that organization comes in and sort of saw there was men and women sitting in a circle talking about Islam, and they immediately said, this is un-Islamic, it's bid'ah, you can't continue. And then, we sort of talked to them, and then they came up with a solution. They said, okay, you can continue if the women in the group sit behind the curtain and the men on the other side, and maybe we'll allow that to happen. But it just so happened that one of the women in the group was fluent in Arabic, fluent in the Quran, and was very ethically oriented, and was able to just in a brief exchange completely refute by citing examples that I hadn't heard of from the time of the Prophet, and they were just completely disarmed, and they had to go away. So that was a little sort of brief moment that I think carries deeper lessons. Now, sometimes you just can't deal with some of these people because they're willing to use force. They're willing to literally use coercion to impose their will. And so there's not much you can do in that situation. But, you have to be well-versed in your own tradition. You have to be better versed in your tradition than your adversaries. But you also need to have a community of activists who can advance those ideas in the broader society. I'm not sure in Malaysia, is there an opportunity here to have, for lack of a better term, a progressive mosque? Can you have a mosque where you can have imams, where you can have meetings, where you can have sort of women who have access to the mosque in the same way that men's do? Or is that completely beyond?
Not in the existing mosques that there are none.
If you tried to do that, they'd shut you down, right?
Well, you can
do it privately.
Rent a place like this and do privately,
but nothing public.
Where you take over a mosque or you build your own mosque.
And all the imams here are paid on government payroll?
Except the privately owned mosque, but most of them are the government-owned mosque.
So theoretically, let's say if I had a lot of money, could I set up my own private mosque here? They would be autonomy to do at least what I wanted?
Many of the past still, the traditional mosque, the past, like Ustaz Hadi's mosque, Yusila, still privately owned. Those that came from father to son, from the
those are privately owned,
And they do their own thing, you know. But what the government does, which is a government strategy, is then to build a government mosque nearby.
Yeah.
And then they start spreading, which was what happened in the 1980s in Tugano and in Kandan. So the way to break the past stranglehold on the community, you know, one of the ways was to build a government mosque, appoint a government imam, and then build low-cost housing, transfer UMNO supporters to the community, and then you start a, a new mosque congregation in that community.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I still, I'm still a firm believer in the value of just sort of education and the value that if, you know, young people who are today more globalized, if they start reading, if they're interested in reading, and if they read some of the books that you've produced, if they read something that Fazlur Rahman or Khalid Abul al-Fadl has written, and if they're, you know, open-minded, that that's going to change how people think about Islam.
You know, I absolutely agree with you. The issue is the numbers, you know, because I know that, you know, when we engage with the women... grassroots training. These are women who don't speak English, who've never left the country.
Yeah.
But, you know, they've had terrible lives under the control of men. You know, so they're open to new ideas.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when we engage with them, when we do the training, you know, the one thing, the feedback that we get is like for 95% of the women, this is the first time.
Yeah.
They've heard the kind of Islam.
Exactly.
And the rights.
Yeah.
You know, that, that actually there are rights for women in Islam. They've never heard of that before. All they know is that they have to obey their husband.
Yeah.
You know? But, you know, so the hope for change is that, and when I engage with students, Malaysian students overseas as well, so much of that conservatism and intolerance is really based on ignorance, not knowing the tradition.
Yeah.
The only tradition they know is a misogynistic, oppressive, undemocratic tradition, because that's what they grew up with in school, mosques, community.
Yeah.
You know, you go to university, even the same. So they're not getting new ideas in their understanding of Islam. And I'm amazed, well, I guess I'm not amazed, like that they have to go to the United States to find out.
Yeah.
There is another Islam.
Yeah.
You know, they have to go to kafir land, infidel land, to find out that, oh my God, there are other Muslims who are different from me, and they don't wear the tudung, and they're very nice. You know, it's like, obviously they never mix with people like us, and you know, because they wear like beyond the pale, can. So they have to, so, and when you engage with them and talk with them, they are open.
Yeah.
Is the lack of this alternative discourse in the media, the schools, the charamas, that's not there.
Yeah.
You know, so I think your idea of curriculum reform is very important, but of course this government is just not willing to reform the curriculum in the way that the Islamic University network in Indonesia, you know, because of the students of Fazlur Rahman who returned, completely changed the curriculum of the Islamic University. It's amazing in Indonesia. You have gender studies in all the Islamic universities. Gender is integrated in Islamic law. Gender is integrated in tafsir. Gender is integrated in, you know, Islamic education. It's just amazing. I came back, I called up University Malaya, University Kebangsaan, so, and they do contemporary ijtihad. They even look at study sisters in Islam letters to the editor and question and answer booklets as part of their education in the Islamic University. They're here, of course, takbir lah kan. So I said, where, because they do contemporary thinkers in Islam. So I asked my friends, so what contemporary thinking do you teach contemporary Islam? It really basically stops at Abdul. Beyond Abdul,
you're kidding.
They don't go beyond, I don't know what it is now, but they don't go at that time, 10 years ago maybe, they don't go beyond Abdul at all, you know. So all these works that's being produced, they just don't study it. And this is part of the problem that we have. And
I
the
agree.
Government is not interested in changing the curriculum.
Yeah.
And in fact, you know, Professor Khalid Masood did a review of the law faculty of UIA many years ago. And he said law is taught as dogma.
Yeah.
Law is not taught as law.
Yeah.
You know, it's dogma, you know. So no possibility of change, of reform. This is divine law, it cannot change. You know, so this is some of the challenge. But so what the question I wanted to ask you is, I mean, what is the role and responsibility of scholars like you, Muslim scholars who's producing this new knowledge to try and, you know, reform the whole, you know, curriculum of teaching Islam You know, not of course in the West that's not a problem, but you know, in the universities, yeah. in the Arab world, in yeah. the Muslim world, is there a yeah. possible way that some international yeah. concerted
yeah.
effort be taken? Yeah. And I've talked with some Al-Azhar people yeah. who are actually willing
yeah.
to look at this
yeah.
issue, you know, to bring together yeah. some of this, you know, some of the scholars yeah. together yeah. to really look at, you know, and I think now is the momentum, you yeah. know, because of what's happening in Syria and Iraq, yeah. you know, for to have that sense of responsibility yeah. and purpose that we really need to look yeah. at reforming the education
yeah, I mean,
system.
In terms of the Arab world, mm. you know, there's not a lot of, at least, hope in terms of systemic and substantive change, because all of these governments are authoritarian and repressive, and they're closed societies, and they have, similar to, I guess, Malaysia, an interest in preventing this type of curriculum reform. But having said that, I think there are little things that can be done within our own capacities that could have, I think, a difference in terms of what you just suggested. Trying to organize meetings where you invite, you know, leading religious scholars from Al-Azhar, from, you know, other parts of the Islamic world, and trying to engage them in sort of, you know, debates, and push them to sort of think about these questions, and to have people who can sort of get them to, that might have an effect. I think, you know, I wouldn't want to completely dismiss every single one of them. I think having meetings, some private, some public, can sort of push some of these people who might be, you know, thinking about these questions to adopt new interpretations. I mean, we're living in, one of the good things, we're living in a globalized world. And, you know, even if you're living in Al-Azhar or some part of the world, you can't, you know, completely shut yourself off from what's happening around the world. You know, it's not like it was, you know, in the 18th century. There are, you know, debates and, you know, there are changes taking place, and we're, and so one of the dominant themes that is just everywhere is the theme of, you know, human rights and democracy. These are sort of the standard references. You know, how do these existing interpretations, you know, meet with that challenge? So I think trying to reach out and engage those people is one thing that can be done. And I think that's what you asked, what can scholars and academics do? That's our job. It's to sort of research, is to interact. We can't, you know, as much as we might want to, we can't completely transform societies. That's the work of generations. It's a long-term project. It's the work of activists. But there, I think the role of, you know, people who are academics is to not only write books, but to also try and engage with people, particularly those that are, they have a different perspective, they have a different sort of ideological worldview, and try and bridge those differences. I suggested today that one of the things that I think made a difference in terms of helping Turkey advance toward democracy is, in the late 1990s, there was this prominent Muslim group that organized these public meetings where people from different ideological camps would be brought together, and they would discuss one particular issue that was relevant to Turkish politics. And these are people who normally would not come together and talk. But you would have a, and these were meetings that were broadcast and they were made public and people could attend. And at the end of the meeting, they would try and get the participants to agree to a memorandum, a statement that encapsulated the consensus. And, you know, that didn't change Turkish politics, but what it did do is it brought people together who previously did not have any contact with one another, who hated each other, were writing in for different communities. It brought them together to force them to interact. It forced them to sort of listen to each other. And it did decrease the polarization that was tearing Turkish society apart. And I think looking back, it did make a small difference, but not an unimportant difference in terms of allowing democracy to advance. So, you know, perhaps something similar like that could be done in the context of, you know, Muslim societies trying to bring people who are willing to have a civil conversation about different interpretations of Islam and what it means for existing societies. How do you deal with the question of multiculturalism, with multi-ethnic societies? How do you deal with the question of gender? How do you deal with sort of, how do you reconcile this interpretation and these justifications and the, you know, abuses that are being done in the name of Islam? Particularly now that, you know, I think this whole ISIS crisis has, for Muslims around the world, including myself, you know, have put us all on the defensive. Because, you know, now the dominant view that most people around the world is, well, this is Islam.
Yeah.
You know, this, where is this interpretation coming? How do you explain this? And, you know, people are all bending over backwards to sort of, you know. So now there is this global focus now, as a result of the, you know, barbaric activity of ISIS, on on Islam and Muslims and modernity, and you know, there might be a chance that to exploit this tragedy that is, you know, unfolding, and to make some change and advance some change in ways. But I think what has to be done is, you know, I mean, communities have to deal with what's happening within their own environment. Malaysians have to be talking to Malaysians to the extent that you can do that. Take advantage of opportunities. I think in many ways, as I said, Malaysia, despite all the problems and difficulties, has much better prospects for the future than the entire Arab world. I mean, I study the Arab world, I study Iran. You know, it's a very dark period now after the Arab Spring, after the ISIS crisis. It's just so disappointing. All the hopes that many of us had 3 years ago that something good could come about have all been dashed. You know, Tunisia is the only last hope. Even Turkey has been backsliding, although I'm still optimistic about Turkey. But the Arab world is just a disaster. And so compared to the Arab world, you know, Malaysia looks like a possibility of greater sort of opportunity that, you know, the Arab world can only dream of. Maybe 20 years from now. So, you know, in that sense, I know that might not be what you want to hear here in this country, but I think if you look at it from a comparative perspective, there's cause for optimism. I was happy to hear about the popular vote going to the opposition in the last election. You know, the work that you've been doing for many years, the work that, you know, Farouk is doing with his institute, the people that you've brought here, all of them are sort of people who I think are basically interested in the same set of concerns. And so Malaysia now that, you know, the Arab world has been completely shut off, can be a focus and a place where perhaps you know, something good can come out of it. But it's going to happen because of, you know, the work that you've been doing, you know, the hard work, the investment, and of course you can't expect rewards in the immediate aftermath. These are long-term projects that have to take place, and maybe generations later will reap the benefits. But I think for everything that I've seen, I'm very encouraged, and so I hope that you'll keep doing what you're doing, because it gives me, from an outsider's perspective, a lot of hope.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah.
Are you aware of this whole debate that's going on here about, you know, using the word Allah by...
I've heard about it, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And correct me if I'm wrong, it's there's a strong opposition, yeah, on behalf of some Muslims to allow other religious groups to use the word Allah.
Yes,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So some of those Muslims,
yeah,
belong to UMNO, which is part of the ruling
party.
The main party.
Right, in the coalition,
the
yeah.
The ruling coalition, yeah. Okay. Now, what's interesting is this. They say, no, non-Muslims can't use this,
yeah,
word, right? But PAS, which is a party that is supposedly Islamic and,
right,
and so on, claims that you can.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering, what is happening in the minds of ordinary Muslims? How do they understand this? They can see that there are two groups,
yeah,
of Muslims,
yeah,
who are saying the opposite.
Yeah.
And how are they able to reconcile this?
Yeah.
And I'm also curious as to why, you know, nobody's saying anything about this. Nobody's looking at it and,
yeah,
saying, you know, what's all this nonsense,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's simply the cynical manipulation of people's identity for political ends. People are trying to create and manufacture a crisis here that really isn't a crisis. You know, what word you want to use to describe God? And in fact, one can make an argument that wouldn't it be great if, you know, we were all sharing something in common? So we use the word God and you use the same word for God, and how you spell it, you know, that's something that can actually be positive because it bridges differences. One can make the argument that this is not something that we need to oppose, but it's something that's great for a particular society that's, you know, multicultural, multi-ethnic. But I think the people who, if you dig deeper, the people who are completely obsessed about this issue, I suspect many of them really don't have a deep interest in the actual specificities of this debate. They're just using it to manipulate people's religious vulnerability as a way of perpetuating their own political power.
Okay. I understand that.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people understand that it's, that this is a political issue.
Yeah.
What I'm just puzzled by is how ordinary Muslims have just become totally...
Yeah. Yeah, and captured by this debate.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. And I see what you're saying. I think you know, this is fundamentally a psychological question, and I think it speaks to those Muslims who are interested in this debate. It speaks to a contemporary crisis within the hearts and minds of many Muslims, where they feel very fragile about their religious identity. They feel that, you know, in many ways that their religion is slipping away, and if they don't adhere to a very rigid interpretation, and if they don't hold on to these symbols, that somehow the entire edifice, the entire, you know, religion is going to come crashing down around them. And so they tend to become very obsessed with these symbols, you know, these symbols of who is allowed to use the word Allah for God. The obsession, and this is something that goes beyond, you know, Malaysia. You know, you see this in a lot of these Islamic revivalist movements, the obsession with appearance, the obsession with insisting that the most important and the only thing that matters for a Muslim woman is whether they cover their hair or they don't. These are all sort of debates that affect and appeal to those people who are facing a certain identity crisis. It's an identity crisis that I think is brought on by the fact that the world is globalized, that they're living in a new environment, that they're challenged by many different things that they sort of hear, and they think if they cling on to this type of, and this is basically the politics of, you know, of what we call in the West religious fundamentalism. There's a sense that people who are going through an identity crisis, they often gravitate to these types of interpretations of Islam or religion, where they think that if they can simply be very strict in the applications, that will solve their problems in the modern world. That will be the way forward. And often you see, you know, in the cases of American prison, I know a lot of, some of my own friends who've been going through personal crises, they will go through a phase in their life when they become very deeply committed to a strict application of the rituals of Islam. You know, you see it in the African American community. This is the example that I was thinking. A lot of African American Muslims, a lot of African Americans who live in a much different socioeconomic status, some of them who go to jail, many of them gravitate to and convert to Islam. And many of them gravitated in the jail systems to this, you know, interpretation of Islam. It's not really Islamic, but it's called the Nation of Islam. Are you familiar with the Nation of Islam?
Yeah.
The Nation of Islam sort of, under this guy Elijah Muhammad, was a very strict, and it appealed to African American men in particular, such as Malcolm X, who were discriminated against. There was a lot of racism, but they felt that the strict rules and rituals could speak to their particular vulnerability, and if they could only latch onto these rules and enforce them, that would give them a sense of purpose, and that would navigate them through the sort of the stormy waters of the modern age that they were living in. And so you see, and this is a byproduct of all fundamentalist movements, just not in the case of Islam, the emphasis on the rituals, the obsession over these little sort of, you know, really insignificant things appeals to people who feel a particular void and vulnerability in those rigid rules that are being insisted upon, gives these vulnerable individuals a certain sense of security. And I can't say anything more than that, because you have to go, this is really in the realm of the psychological and you know, you really need a psychiatrist or a psychologist to be able to give you a deeper examination. But that's how I understand it. Unfortunately, some people, you know, they get caught up in these debates. They think it's important. Many of us just laugh at it, you know. But people who feel vulnerable in many ways, for whatever reason, try to compensate their vulnerability by latching onto these debates.
You know, I was at a recent seminar in Germany where I met Moroccan Muslims, Tunisians, Lebanese.
Yeah.
And when we discussed this whole Allah issue they were just
baffled.
Laughing.
Yeah.
They were baffled. They were, you know, so amused by it, and they were horrified.
Yeah.
you know,
because I think Christian, actually, Christian Arabs in Lebanon and in other parts, they actually use Allah.
Yes.
It's not an issue. Yeah.
Yeah, and for a lot of these people, from afar, Malaysia looked like the place, you know, the model.
Yeah.
So they were very.
I mean, it'd be interesting to look at how this debate actually started and who sort of started to advance this. I mean, this is sort of classical. I hate to say it, but one of the big problems that we're facing here is this is sort of the corrosive effects of the spread of Wahhabi Islam that comes out of Saudi Arabia and that has now contaminated large parts of the Islamic world. And the ISIS connection here that hasn't really been discussed until relatively recently. I mean, one of the interesting things about the ISIS phenomenon in Iraq is that the theological interpretation of the ISIS activists is straight out of the playbook of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. You know, and what's interesting about Saudi Arabia is that politically Saudi Arabia doesn't like the ISIS activists, but theologically they can't criticize them because, and in fact I've actually heard and read reports where theological texts of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab are actually disseminated in the ISIS areas. And so, you know, this is the corrosive effect. Someone was at one of the meetings today, and they were saying, look, in the 1950s here in Malaysia, we didn't have these problems and these tensions between the different groups. It wasn't this bad. And he's right, because, you know, these types of interpretations of Islam that are trying to, you know, exploit these, you know, issues and put these, you know, debates on the table that are completely insignificant are coming out of a particular interpretation of Islam that is deeply puritanical, you know, anti-women, anti-minority, anti-Shia, and it's you know, I remember just in Canada when I was, not too long ago, I was still a graduate student, where one day I'm just, you know, reading the news and it's announced that some imam from a conservative mosque in Canada has issued this new fatwa. It's called the Merry Christmas Fatwa. Have you heard of it? You heard of it? Similar things here. Well, you can't say Merry Christmas to your Christian friends because that's. And so, when in the history of Islam has it ever been forbidden that you can't wish, you know, Merry Christmas or you know, to your Christian neighbor? This is a complete new sort of, you know, interpretation where if you go back, it's just unheard of. But it's coming out of a particular interpretation, a particular worldview that unfortunately has a lot of, you know, resources behind it, and it's corrupting and corroding, you know, Muslim hearts and minds, and this is a problem, you know.
So if in Canada you have somebody would issue a fatwa like that, have you had experiences in Canada or other Western countries where imams or people in that kind of position issue fatwas concerning Valentine's Day?
Yes. Similar, yeah, a similar thing.
Global movement.
Yeah, it's the same thing. It's the same thing. I've heard of the Valentine's Day, but, you know, in one sense, you know, Islam, unlike Catholicism, is you know, it's anyone can issue a fatwa, right? And unfortunately, the people who issue the more ridiculous fatwa often get a lot of media attention. What's really sad is how some Muslims will end up believing this. And this speaks to those Muslims who feel vulnerable, who feel fragile, who feel that if they can be really strict in applying all of these rigid things, it'll somehow give them a sense of security. Now, the good thing about Canada is that it's an open society, so some mosques are, you know, can say these things, other mosques can't, and there's at least a little bit of more internal accountability. And if you don't like a mosque, you can often go to another mosque that doesn't have these shenanigans taking place. But I know it's a very different story in the case of Malaysia, and particularly in the case of the, you know, Arab and Islamic world, and in Iran, where the state is all dominant and, you know, does not allow for the type of freedom of expression and choice that we would like to see.
But still in some masjids, mosques, Muslims, Sunni and Shia pray together. And it's still okay.
Where?
Well, maybe in the south, where you have Sunni and Shia presence together.
South in this country?
Iran.
In Iran.
I was talking about Iran.
Yeah, in Iran, I mean, I remember growing up in Canada, there was never this issue of Sunni or Shia. Mm. You know, my parents come from Iran. We went to the local mosque. Nobody said anything. What really happened was in 1979, 1980, as a result of the Iranian Revolution and as a result of the Saudi attempt to push back against the spread of popular revolutionary Islam, where this issue between Sunni and Shia, you know, became a problem. Prior to that, you know, I remember even talking to, you know, people from South Asia, from Pakistan, who would say that, yeah, you know, we would have Shia Muslims, we have Sunni Muslims, they would have their own festivals, sometimes we would, you know, participate in them. But nowadays, to sort of suggest that, that sort of Sunni Muslims and Shia Muslims can sort of get together is, you know, is completely unheard of. But in a previous, so this is happening for precise reasons because there's political interests that have been involved in fanning these flames.
You know, on that curriculum idea that you were talking about, do you see that PASS can be a vehicle for championing the changes to the curriculum?
I mean, there are factions. I mean, for me, the positive side is that you see that the Islamist movements are shifting.
Yes.
That,
yeah.
You know, they're breaking up the groups within.
Yeah.
You know, you have more, like, you know, like in PASS, you have more progressive people in PASS,
yeah.
You know, and for them to take the position, you know, and theologically, they did their research to support the use of Allah,
yeah.
You know, by anyone.
Yeah.
So I think there are factions within PASS. So I you know, Nadir's suggestion that, you know, I think, you know, that how do we get the more open-minded? They may not be all the way with this, but
yeah.
They obviously are dealing with the realities, changing realities on the ground.
Yeah.
Like for the first time, Sisters in Islam was invited by
PASS
Muslimat to their annual general meeting, you know, which was interesting. So obviously they want to reach out.
Yeah.
You know, and they want to, well, this is of course a progressive section, you know, they want to present a different face of PASS, you know.
Yeah.
I think the fact that Ikram, you know, the whole, you know, Pakatan Rakyat Reformasi movement also, you know, has brought together groups that's never been brought together before.
I think those are important that need to be built, those types of, you know, changes and bringing people together, I think you shouldn't downplay the importance because they can often lead to perhaps change that you can't see immediately but down the road.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure if PASS is doing this, inviting you because it's a reflection of a serious change or they're calculating that there's some political advantage to be gained from doing this in terms of their popular support. Could be both.
Well, I think that, you know, because they're part of Pakatan Rakyat and, you know, they feel that they should engage with civil society more, you know, which is interesting.
Yeah.
And publicly acknowledging us as well.
Yeah.
When they gave their welcome speech, you know. And there are some past members there who don't like us, you know.
Yeah. So that's good. I mean, the worst thing that can happen in these contexts is to sort of give up and become apathetic and say, look, it's just a completely lost cause. I don't care anymore. I'm just going to pursue my own material interests, and that's all that matters. What's so encouraging is that at least here there's people who are organized. Civil society is organized. There's debates that are happening. People have been, I mean, you've been fighting this for how many years now?
21
years. Yeah. So, I mean, that's very encouraging. The worst thing that can happen, and this is what authoritarian regimes want, they count on other members of society becoming disorganized and giving up and going away. Then they can continue on. But the worst scenario for existing centers of power that are in power is to have an organized opposition that is still agitating and pushing. Their ideal scenario is to have everyone just go about their own business and just pursue their own material or interests and let things stay the same. So. The worst scenario. So that's why I was so encouraged when I heard the 83% voter turnout. I think as long as people are willing to still engage in politics, then that provides, you know, hope. So
maybe we have one more question and try to wrap up.
Any last question? Spencer?
Well, I guess... from listening to, you know, several discussions all weekend, I think it's all very interesting. And I'm from the United States, by the way. So,
where are you from?
My university's in Ohio, Cincinnati. I go to Xavier University. Just recently graduated.
It's a Catholic school, right?
It is. Yes. Yeah. I have a fellowship to come study Islam and democracy. So I've been in Indonesia. I'm in Malaysia now. I'm interested in. I think it's important to take all these great ideas and put them into practice.
Yeah.
And so I'm interested if you could comment a little bit more. I know you've talked about, you know, that how going to the grassroots level is very important and creating these spaces for dialogue, especially within the Muslim community.
Yeah.
But... from my perspective, it seems very difficult to do that when the state is promoting, controlling the religion, essentially.
Right.
And most of the Muslim countries in the world are authoritarian.
Right.
So how do you go about creating those spaces for dialogue?
Yeah.
How do you go about doing it at the grassroots level?
Yeah.
under that situation?
Yeah.
I mean, what are the political or social structures needed to even start that conversation?
Well, no, it's a good question. And I think, you know, one size doesn't fit all here. Some societies have greater opportunities to organize at the grassroots level than others. Take, for example, a country that I know very well. If you tried to do this in the Islamic Republic of Iran, you get arrested and beaten and thrown in jail. In Malaysia here is different. I would like to think that if, let's say, people in this room wanted to go to some small Malaysian town or, you know, location outside of the capital city here and organize perhaps a meeting, a seminar, a discussion, that there would be opportunities to do that and that the state wouldn't intervene, because the state here is, you know, has certain limits in terms of how far it can go and repress civil society. So if there's an opportunity to do that, I think those opportunities should be pursued. One example that might be helpful here, I've been spending a little bit of time in Tunisia recently, and Tunisia's path to democracy has been relatively successful. One of the things that the Tunisians had to deal with is writing a new constitution. And the constitution was very difficult to write because you had polarized communities along an Islam, basically a religious Islamist versus secularist line, and a lot of polarity. But one of the things that was being done by a friend of mine was that he, in order to bridge the gaps, in order to write this constitution, he started to organize local meetings in different societies and communities throughout Indonesia, bringing people together who normally would not talk to each other to talk about the different articles and themes of the constitution that had to be negotiated. And literally, over the course of the last 2.5 years when the constitution was being written, he told me that they had about 200 to 300 meetings. I attended two of their conferences, which were very impressive, because at these conferences you would have people from across the political spectrum coming to the same conference and commenting on a particular question. They had different views, but they were willing to listen to each other and dialogue with one another. In terms of the constitution writing, they were actually going to local towns and setting up meetings and announcing it at the local, you know, bazaar and in the mosque, and anyone who could come would participate. And of course, most people at the grassroots level, it's a very poor society, didn't have the interest because they're just trying to survive. But those people who did actually came, and a lot of the ability to bridge the tensions in terms of writing the constitution of Tunisia was done because when the delegates got together, a lot of the preliminary work had been done at the grassroots level. So I think, you know, the answer to your question is that to the extent that there is an opportunity in any particular Muslim community to go to the grassroots level, to organize a local meeting that can bring people together who normally do not meet or have not met, and the state will not intervene, or other forces in society will not try to break it up, then I think those are opportunities that have to be exploited and advanced. And that's really where the, you know, the difficult work is done. But don't underestimate the work that's being done, at least by, you know, organizations such as yourself, because part of the strategy for change is someone has to come up with the broad ideas. You know, you have to have that sort of, you know, the books, the ideas, the manuals. That has to be there as, I think, a preliminary step. And then the next step is to try and disseminate those ideas and get them into a broader community and translate those ideas, because you can't expect an average, let's say, Malaysian or an average person, let's say, in the, you know, let's say in the Arab world, to pick up Khalid Abu Fadl speaking in God's name and be able to read it and understand it, right? Those are dense texts that are meant for a specialized audience. What you really need is translating those ideas at the grassroots level. You know, look at local authority. Who are the local authority figures in a local community? It'll be the imam, it'll be some community leader, it'll be someone who has, and try to the extent that they're open, work with them, engage them if they're willing to have a conversation. And so that's a big strategy. The other thing, I still sort of, like I said, I'm an old-fashioned believer in the power of education. I'd like to think that the more literacy rates go up, the more that young students go to university, the more that they're exposed to ideas. I mean, I don't know what the university system is like here, but universities, you know, in the case of the Arab world and in the case of Iran that I know a bit better, you know, those are have been bastions of political reform and change because there was a certain autonomy that universities had. People would be, you could have exposure to ideas and debates. The state would be reluctant at least a little bit to come in. So I'd like to think that university and colleges here perhaps could be avenues where young people can be engaged with new ideas, exposed to new ideas, and then they will, in their own way, you know, take those ideas and try to bring about change.
Yeah. How about you know, the progressive scholars coming together and doing, like, provide an alternative Islamic studies
curriculum? Yeah, that's a good idea.
On Coursera, yeah. You know, on e-course, massive online.
Yeah, that'd be a good idea.
To really work on it so that there's an alternative that young people, that students, because I think there is a hunger for it now. We're not meet the education, the universities and all that are not meeting it, but I think we need to build an alternative source of knowledge for these students.
I mean, what do you mean exactly? Like, if
you
some
know, like say your two courses put that online as
but those courses are for largely an American non-Muslim audience who just wants to have a basic sort of understanding. It's for, it's not what I think we really need here in terms of, I think what we really need is what a curriculum for Islamic, for an Islam understanding of, you know, Islam in the modern world would be.
Let's develop that curriculum. I mean, Musawa has a training.
Yeah.
We have a training curriculum. And there's demand for it.
Yeah.
And we are thinking of doing online course because we cannot meet the demand. So obviously, there's for us, the target will be women's rights activists and human rights activists. And, you know, this year we've done training in the Maldives, we did training in Afghanistan. We're doing a training for South Asia. Next year we're doing training for MENA region. We're doing training for Horn of Africa. So there is a hunger for a way to understand Islam.
Why don't you do it in Malaysia?
In Malaysia, sisters in Islam,
they do it. Training. So can you go to a small town and village where there's a lot of sort of rural support for the ruling government, and they're more susceptible to sort of there? Can you go there and sort of set up, let's say, a training?
On who do we work with? We've discovered a few of our trainings have been cancelled. You know, because they were pressured, including by the bloody opposition. As well, one of the trainings was cancelled by the PKR member of parliament or state assemblyman. Others cancelled by UMNO people who intervened and said, no, don't hold. So then we have to choose a grassroots partner that has the strength to withstand.
So that's how we have to do it. They're going to get. So that's the answer partial to your question, too. You have to be very strategic about how you go into the grassroots. You have to know the political landscape, who are the potential people who are going to oppose it, and how can you navigate. And sometimes you're just not going to be able to do it because the obstacles are too big. But if there is a way of getting into, you know, those communities and talking to people who have, you know, connections.
But basically we can. I mean, we work with the single mothers groups a lot, you know, because they have problems. You know, with the Sharia courts, with their husbands, with all the men, their sons, with all the men in their lives. You know, so definitely there are openings, you know, that you can reach out to them.
I mean,
you know, if you do it through, say, applied training for single mothers, I think it's a kind of like, you know, you could just get in, right? But if you went there and said, I want to hold a 5-day or 3-day course on a modern interpretation of Islam, I think.
No, you don't do, strategically, you don't do such things. You know, you talk about, you know, the Islamic family law. You know, so that would be the entry point. You have to enter, you have to strategically figure out what is the issue that can provide you the entry point into discussing the larger issue of rights and Islam. You know, in Indonesia, they began with reproductive health issues. In Malaysia, we began with family law issues.
So I think we'll be slowly finalizing our today's meeting. It was quite long already. I think that your say, Dr. Hashimi, here in Malaysia was quite fruitful in terms of producing new ideas and getting acquainted with the new theory and rethinking the old concepts. And I hope for you it was beneficial too, that you could learn something from Malaysia and for you could share it with your colleagues and your students.
It was. I will give them a very positive report about my trip when I go back.
So we thank you, and that's the end of our meeting.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.